one, and a happy new year!
Black music in the 80s was about revolutions. On TV, on the radio, and on the turntable.
There was a huge transformation in terms of the music video, in terms of the social circumstances, and in terms of the artistic creativity.
It was also about making artistic compromises and a struggle to bring true black music to the mainstream. And in the 80s, that meant rap.
It was different. It wasn't our parents' music. It really spoke to a young generation. It was a sort of new creation that became sort of a soundtrack to our lives.
The music born out of 70s block parties in the South Bronx went national in 1980 when the Sugar Hill Gang's Rapper's Delight hit the top 40 and sold more than 3 million copies.
Now what you hear is not a test, I'm rapping to the beat.
It was just like, wow, what's that? It was so much fun. You know, I mean, if you liked words, it was so much fun. You know, and it wasn't too bad if you liked beats either.
You see, I am Wonder Mike, and I like to say hello.
It won you over. You know, it won you over with the hip hop, the hip, hip hop. You don't stop, rock to the bang bang, boogie, up, jump the boogie to the rhythm of the boogie to beat. Who don't know that?
It was all about fun and having a good time. The lyrics were fun, and it was fresh and new.
Check it out. When I'm pimp the dimp, the ladies pimp, the women fight for my dear life.
The next day was like, you know, 3 million copies. 3 million copies sold.
But not everyone was delighted. Sugar Hill Records empress Sylvia Robinson created the group to exploit the street phenomenon.
They had these DJs just rapping on top of music, and I said, well, if that went on record, that would really be great.
I remember at the time, some of us that were coming up in hip-hop were a little disappointed that the first big major hip-hop record was the Sugar Hill Gang, simply because before that record, we never even heard of the Sugar Hill Gang.
Rapper's Delight is fake. It's a bunch of guys who copped, bit the style. They were just first, but they weren't really rappers.
Any of the controversy surrounding how it was produced or made at this point is neither here nor there for me. It opened up the door on a national basis for other rap records to come down the pipe.
Despite the success of Rapper's Delight, rap music itself was still mostly an underground phenomenon. The industry considered it a passing fad and continued to market black music as it always had, separately.
At the beginning of the 80s, black music was perceived as a niche. It was seen as, you know, having had this great heyday in the 60s, you know, had some interesting, smart, artistic breakthroughs, you know, Stevie Wonder, Marvin Gaye in the 70s, and then plateaued.
There was this sense that still there was certain walls. To get across that wall was still a big, big deal for a lot of these black artists.
The charts were definitely dominated by white artists, the pop charts, and the black artists were sort of relegated to the R&B charts.
In 1981, MTV launched and changed the music industry overnight. But not for black artists. MTV was programmed like a classic rock radio station. White music, white bands.
I'm just floored by the fact that there's so few black artists featured on it. Why is that?
We have to play the music that we think an entire country is going to like. You pick some town in the Midwest that will be scared to death by a string of black faces.
Interesting. Okay, thank you very much.
With rap still simmering in the underground, it was black pop artists who faced the immediate challenge of bringing black music to MTV. And they did.
Because it's all about control.
Some were cute. Some were in control, and some were just looking for a little controversy.
Controversy.
The first black artist to find acceptance on MTV didn't fit anyone's idea of what a black pop star should look, sound, or act like.
Let's go.
His name was Prince, and he was funky.
I'm just like anyone else. I need love and water.
Prince wasn't just an R&B artist like so many other black artists were in the 80s. He could sort of transcend different musical genres.
Don't have to be beautiful.
He wasn't pure black music. He wasn't pure pop music. He wasn't pure rock and roll. He was all of it.
I just want your extra time and your
anybody bigger than Michael? No.
Absolutely, hands down, no.
singer, dancer, everyone.
They played Michael so much, it was like on the hour, the top of the hour, we're gonna play Thriller.
Shut away!
You go to your friend's house, like, okay, we're gonna sit here until Thriller comes on, because we gotta see this thing, because it's incredible.
Thriller was the biggest album of all time, with more than 45 million copies sold. The success of Prince and Michael Jackson meant new opportunities for 70s stars who had been left behind. Lionel Richie became a superstar in the 80s by embracing the pop mainstream and ditching the fortified funk of his 70s group, the Commodores.
Lionel had huge hits with the Commodores, and then he was looking at the market and he was saying things like, I can make, you know, Hello.
Hello. Is it me you're
looking for? Lionel's songwriting was so universal. Whether you like Lionel Richie or not, the list goes on and on of songs that are absolutely going to be around for 100 years. Songs that appeal to every age and every race.
If I'm in a very uptight mood, I write a song. If I'm in a happy mood, I write a song.
Of seeing Whitney's first public performance. And what was interesting about it was she was this stunningly beautiful girl, but rough.
With the help of Arista Records czar Clive Davis, Whitney was transformed overnight into the girl next door, the girl who just happened to be black.
Suddenly, she's repackaged as this diva type pop superstar who was acceptable to blacks and whites.
Contrast to the grim realities of inner city life.
You had this environment where government programming had been cut back across the board.
Reagan's working the okey-doke on your ass, and the gap between rich and poor is getting wider.
Black music's next big moment delivered something sorely needed. The truth was about to hit the mainstream.
Only when black people have their backs against the walls does real creativity emerge.
By far the most lucrative form of black music in the early 80s. But the success of Rapper's Delight had brought rap culture briefly into the mainstream. And some black artists began using elements of hip-hop in their music and videos.
Chaka 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 Khan. Chaka Khan.
These were gentle introductions to the sounds of this strange new thing called rap, courtesy of non-threatening artists like Chaka Khan.
Feel for you.
The more authentic form of hip-hop was still struggling to be heard, and a group from the South Bronx was about to make that happen. A song called The Message by Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five mixed social commentary into the grooves for the first time.
It's like a jungle sometimes. It makes me wonder how I keep from going under.
In contrast to the fluffy sentiments of platinum-selling black pop, The Message was nothing less than a statement of purpose.
I can't walk through the park because it's crazy after dark. Keep my hand on my gun because they got me on the run.
I remember I was inside the pool hall on Hollis Avenue, and The Message came on the radio. It was so different because we were just in the streets rapping, my DJ's better than your DJ, throw your hands in the air.
At that time, everybody was making party records and get up and move and shake yourself. And this particular record was painting a picture of everything that was going on around us in New York City.
Broken glass everywhere, people pissing on the stage, you know they just don't care.
It spoke to us in a different kind of way, like, wow, this is real.
Rats in the front room, roaches in the back, junkies in the alley with the baseball bat.
Within this really catchy song that you jammed to at the club was a cry out from the inner cities. Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five are the town criers for this new generation that's growing up.
Don't push me, cause I'm close to the edge.
Now, one of the big effects of this kind of, you know, reportage from the inner city was that, you know, a lot of white kids sitting in posh suburbs said, like, hey, God, that sounds like really exciting.
Oh, my God. The music just turns me on.
That this burgeoning culture of b-boying and breakdancing and then rap music would constitute a huge cultural explosion that now has global exposure. Nobody could have predicted it.
This is a journey into sound.
Create revenue, but it drew in a huge, unexpected audience. The white folks.
Watch me grow.
rap records was a window into a world that people only read about or heard about word of mouth. They're like, this must be what's going on in the hood.
And what that did was transcend to every state everywhere.
It was just, come on in, everybody, come on in, come on in. You can have this too, come on in.
The giants of television, advertising, and film heard this invitation and gladly accepted.
Get busy, y'all.
You want to take it out the parks, you want to have it on the radio, you want people to say, this isn't a fad. You want people to say that, so you got to go take whatever comes along with people accepting it, and that's commercialization.
Ironically enough, the actual music biz dragged its feet in discovering rap's profit potential. Record companies initially dismissed it as a nuisance, a passing fad.
None of these companies wanted anything to do with hip-hop.
Well, the original. It didn't fit their format.
So, in a vacuum, there's an opportunity.
One man battled these naysayers and built an empire in the process.
We made their format come to us.
Russell Simmons would implement his strategy for world domination by carefully grooming his acts for maximum crossover success.
It's like that, and that's the way it is.
Enter Run DMC.
Run DMC opened the door to the masses in the mid-80s.
They became undeniable. They were the first rap group on American Bandstand. They were the first rap group on the cover of Rolling Stone. They were the first rap group to sell 3 million records.
That was the crossover with Run DMC. That was the crossover. When you saw them get up with that rock, then that's what everybody was like.
When they got together with Aerosmith, that was just genius.
One, two, three, four!
In 1987, Raising Hell, the album featuring the famous collaboration with Aerosmith, became the first multi-platinum rap album in history. Russell and Def Jam were also responsible for LL Cool J, the buff body, gruff-sounding rapper who became the genre's first solo star.
He was the first person I seen that had that, besides me, that had that young boy swagger.
Screaming on you and stomping on you like you a jelly bean, and nothing's gonna stand in his way.
I'm notorious, I'll crush you like a jelly bean. I'm bad.
Success earned legions of white rap fans. Simmons saw this and made his biggest score with a trio of white homeboys.
Kick it!
The white people were psyched when they first saw the Beastie Boys, because then it was like, oh, rap music. I get it.
You gotta fight for your right to party.
The Beastie Boys were white. Of course they were gonna break through.
But they could rap. You can't take anything away from it. They made good records.
The Beastie Boys were the ultimate sign of commercialized hip-hop. But they had a street cred, and black audiences welcomed them with open arms.
They were true to hip-hop. They weren't faking, like they weren't trying to be black. So black people liked them, too.
Hip-hop became a massive money-making force, filling the pockets of companies lucky enough to stumble on the B-boy vogue.
My Adidas
really, really needs to give a lifetime check to Run DMC.
My Adidas. Come on.
Run DMC made me get Adidas.
Every time the two of us were pulling the town, everybody would have on Adidas suits and Adidas. I mean, Adidas shirt, everything was Adidas. We got kind of nervous because we was like, yo, this rap thing is really powerful.
Hip-hop's influence on fashion wasn't limited to footwear.
Hip-hop has always been an influence on how all of us dressed. That's where it all started.
Run your Gucci, your Louis, and your fresh gold chain.
Gazelle glasses and Kango hats were hip-hop's accessories of choice.
Kango one, a pair of Gazelles, a pair of white-on-white Adidas with fat laces.
Gazelles were these real ugly goggle-like frames that were probably bigger than 60% of your face. Once Gazelles came out, everybody wore glasses.
The Kango hat, one of the main regrets I've ever had was the fact that I couldn't rock a bucket over my head.
No.
And if MTV's down with it, it's making moves.
No.
Yo MTV rap is what introduced hip-hop to the white people.
White kids knew what to listen to in the 80s, thanks to two men, Ed Lover
and Dr. Dre. The fat one.
Hit me!
Yo, hi, Mom!
That was major. I mean, MTV making a commitment to hip hop through Yo was like the best thing that could have happened to hip hop internationally.
Dog talk, baby.
Between 1985 and 1988, hip hop experienced a literal explosion, going from underground curiosity to global phenomenon.
Everyone like breakdance.
Crack hit. It definitely affected the music.
It seemed like it became a circle, really, where after we started talking about it, more people started being involved in selling dope.
By the end of the decade, a new generation of rap artists emerged, exposing the pain, anger, and frustration of their communities to the world.
These records begin reflecting the new reality of the streets of America. The violent music comes from violent times.
Ruthless gangster definition, villain.
This new and aggressive form of rap came straight from the underground, demanded attention, and forced mainstream audiences to recognize that black experience wasn't one size fits all.
A young brother from the West Coast, L.A., South Central, fool where the Crips and the Blood play.
Ice-T is the godfather of gangster rap.
One wrong move and your cap's peeled.
Ice-T was the first gangster rapper.
Original gangster,
OG. He's a street reporter. He was giving you a glimpse of life in the streets.
Yeah! L.A. brother Ice-T helped show that while hip-hop had its origins in the East Coast inner cities, the music's newest innovation was strictly a West Coast thing.
They're dealing with gangs, they're dealing with bandanas, they're dealing with colors, stuff that even hardcore rap in the East is not.
They start telling you about police brutality and how the police was acting out there in L.A.
Brothers were catching hell in L.A. at that point.
If you from Atlanta, you never got a chance to be in L.A., you got some kind of idea now because the rappers was that voiceover and they told you everything about their hood.
Formed with cash from their leaders' drug operations, N.W.A. represented hip-hop's new gangster lane, and they were hell-bent on getting all up in America's face.
Straight out of Compton.
The first time I heard N.W.A., I thought it was the most incredible thing I've ever heard.
When we heard N.W.A., for us, it was like, wow, here comes another perspective.
Got him.
I was on the East Coast, so to me, it was like, what are those people with those Jerry curls talking about?
Taking a life or two, that's what the hell I do. You don't like how I'm living with you.
Even their name was like a giant middle finger to the mainstream.
It's a fresh name, N.W.A., niggas with attitude. I could see a bunch of niggas sitting in the room making that up. Like, yo, we N.W.A., niggas. With attitude, word up. I could see that. They was just raw.
F***s and bitches and sluts.
Keep in mind, there wasn't much cussing in rap.
They was cursing.
Life ain't nothing but f***s and money.
I got a weapon for listening to N.W.A.
N.W.A. refused to censor themselves, and they wore their complete disregard for authority like a badge.
But them dudes was like, f*** the police.
The police coming straight from the underground. A young nigga got it bad, because I'm brown.
I'm like, oh! No! I thought, okay, this must be like some other stuff.
Well, they're critical of the police, telling the police, you know, if I'm a gangster and you violate my territory, I'm gonna come at you because I think you a gangster.
A bitch is a bitch.
His attitude is both a sign of rebellion, and it's a joke. It's kind of funny. You know what I mean? Like, I'm just gonna take it all the way out and see what people say.
Are you the kind that think you're too damn fly? Bitch, eat and die.
There were a lot of people that were shocked. You know, I can't believe that they're saying that.
Many people were shocked, but more were fascinated. And for N.W.A., that meant big sales.
N.W.A. blew up very quickly. They had a number one record with no support from any record label.
Everybody said, ooh, you know, they can't say that. Let me buy it.
And that's when we started seeing that in hip-hop, the damn controversy is a selling point.
All of a sudden, they were everywhere. White kids were blasting it. Everybody was blasting N.W.A.
The audience, they got a taste of some gangster rap, and they was like, oh, we like this.
A lot of white kids embraced it, and, you know, and it became like their black studies class.
By the end of the 80s, N.W.A.'s brand of renegade rap was becoming the most popular form of hip-hop.
What started to happen is that you had this one-upmanship.
within the genre. The more negative I make this rap, the more records I sell.
You could mass market this NWA sound and put those videos and those images on TV, then that's what people wanted to buy.
So the artists started making that type of music. We're like, yo, we go give y'all what y'all want.
This is the kind of music that has corporate support.
And the record companies happily churned out profitable gangster hits that glorified and romanticized death and drug dealing.
Don't quote me, boy, cause I ain't said shit.
People focus on the gangster thing because the gangster thing was the most controversial. But it wasn't the only thing happening in hip-hop.
Along with groups venting their anger, others, like Boogie Down Productions leader KRS-One, were using the music to try and heal the black community.
They're trying to drop knowledge on people, telling them, come on, man, let's get our heads together.
KRS-One is the epitome of what a hip-hopper should be.
KRS-One, he was the teacher.
We got ourselves together so that you could unite and fight for what's right.
Self-destruction, they'll play in the club, and you weren't supposed to play a record that's trying to give you a message like that in the club. Them records was really important because they made kids realize that we need to stop.
And then there was Public Enemy.
I got a letter from the government the other day. I opened and read it and said they were suckers.
Rising out of the East to become the biggest rap force on the planet, P.E. were the perfect late 80s hip-hop act. Rebels without a pause, but always down for the cause.
We're one of the voices that were able to take a lot of the different voices that were being heard and corral them up into one center point and have this discussion.
Because I'm militant, posing a threat, you better government.
They spoke about drugs infiltrating the communities. They spoke about racism.
They're talking about classism, poverty. They're talking about issues that affect urban youth.
And they had a crew behind them that'll whoop your ass if you get out of line.
By the end of the 80s, the continued expansion of the black music market allowed some new voices to be heard, and they were heard in decidedly genre-defying ways.
Once people were able to swallow the pill of hip-hop, that made it easier for other genres. It wasn't that different to have a black rock group or a black alternative group.
Chrissy Chapman, Living Color, Terrence Trent D'Arby, Fishbone. These are artists who are saying they have something to say, and they're going to say it the way they want to say it.
But there were unique obstacles along the way.
Don't you know we're talking about a revolution?
Tracy Chapman's heartfelt and decidedly political songs stood in stark contrast to the status quo of both black music and white.
Don't you know you better run, 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 run.
She was very quiet, she was very focused, she was very political, and she really restored an element of kind of seriousness to what popular music was about.
She's talking about poverty, the effects of Reaganomics, things that are real to black people. Because she's singing the folk tradition, perhaps some African Americans did not readily identify with her right away. But after a while listening to her, I think she was able to reach more and more people.
Tracy's self-titled debut album was simply the biggest hit record of 1988. It was Living Color. Four black guys who made it clear that rock music wasn't a whites-only domain.
So why you wanna give me that 25?
The idea of a black rock and roll band seemed unique to a lot of people.
Even though we invented the music, I think there's a lot of people that don't really understand that we invented the music.
The conventional history of rock and roll is Negroes hollering in a field, you know, Chuck Berry, the Beatles, Hendrix, and then with blacks, it ends with Hendrix.
I'm a stranger in a strange land.
It was a kind of rebuke to the music industry in a certain way. Like, well, you're black, like you're in the R&B field. You're black, you're a hip-hop artist. If you're black and you want to play rock and roll, well, that's a little trickier.
But a great song has always broken barriers, and Living Color had one in their smash hit, Cult of Personality.
From the very beginning, movies could rely on homosexuality as a surefire source of humor.
I
a man or a woman, what it means to have sexuality. The movies did provide us with some kind of history of how society
personality.